you for inviting me for this event. I'm happy to be here, and this is my first time in Mexico, and I really, really enjoy the country and Guanajuato, Mexico City, and I would see more things like next week. So welcome everybody. So this morning talks will be about like topic models and their application to video analysis. And I'm a researcher at IDIAP in Martini, and I'm also kind of assistant professor at EPFL. So just to give some information about geography, I mean, just so here you have a map of Europe, and as you see here, Switzerland is quite at the center of it, as well the western part. But although it's at the center of Europe, it's part of your European community. So it's a very specific thing, but we are quite involved in European research in general. So now if we zoom a bit and we look at the map of Switzerland, so Switzerland is quite a country with like lots of mountains in the south and more like flat areas and lot of lakes, as you can see it. And maybe you know Geneva, the name, so there's a lake here, and at the end you have Geneva. At the top here you have EPFL and Lausanne. And here you have the Rhone Valley, which is a river flowing from here towards like the Mediterranean Sea. And Martini is located here exactly at this angle. And the institute is where I'm working. So I'm working between here and EPFL in general. So the IDIAP Research Institute, just to give you some basic information, it was founded in 91. So maybe, if I understand well, 1 year after CIMAT. And it was founded by Dale Mole, who was a guy who made like fortune choke. And then he had years and he had some fortune, so he decided to found like three institutes in Switzerland, and so through those three institutes started. But now there's no more money coming from there, but at least this is what gave the impulse to the creation of this institute. So it's a not-for-profit foundation. It has an academic affiliation with EPFL. In terms of human resources, it's around 100 people, so 13 permanent researchers, 15 postdocs on average, like 33 PhD students, which are mainly registered at EPFL. And it's quite international. Usually we are between 20 and 35 nationalities in the institute, so it's very nice to work there. And obviously, English is the working language. The funding is around 10 million euros, which comes around like nowadays 50%, you say, like base funding from different levels of city, state, federal, and 50% from projects, mainly research projects from Europe and Switzerland. And the main research area are centered around human analysis. So there's some applied machine learning or less applied machine learning with people doing statistical learning, people doing deep learning. Unfortunately, some of these people left for other places in the US. And also perception, so computer vision. There is a large group as well in speech processing, which is the director of IDIAP is actually working in this field and is very famous for that. And there is also quite some aspect about human and social behavior, like trying to analyze the interaction between people and to derive some information about what people are doing, people, what are their personality, who is the dominant person in a room. And actually some work that is led by a Mexican researcher called Gabriel. And there's also applications, I mean, groups about biometrics, robotics, biomedical images. With respect to me, so my research interests are mainly about human activity recognition from multimodal sensors, but mainly computer vision and audio processing. So the task I'm addressing is trying to detect people, track them, and so on, and potentially enlarge, enrich this information with other information, like pose information or gaze information, for instance. After that, we try to go to the activity level, so trying to infer behavior, or for instance, attention modeling in interactions, who is looking at whom or what. Or for instance, in interaction, when somebody speaks, is he speaking to me or is he speaking to the robot, for instance, if it's in human robot interaction. And in terms of models, I'm quite using a lot of statistical models, mainly Bayesian model, graphical models. I will speak about it a bit later. And in terms of application, it's kind of surveillance, man-machine interface, robotics, and also multimedia content analysis. So that's a bit for introductory about me and where I'm coming from. So this morning is about topic models and the application to video analysis. So it's very introductory. So I will go through the different steps, maybe some of the things you already know and so on. I hope it's not going to be too boring. We'll see. If you have any questions, sometimes let me know. Okay, so what is topic model? So this is topic model originates from the text processing community in the 90s, and mainly towards like a more general goal, which was, okay, what is the meaning of words? And in particular, not from you know, the analysis of the words over time, the semantics over time, but more from a statistical viewpoint. So essentially, if you take a text collection, whether it's text of laws or books and novels, article from a journal, from the journal Science, for instance, taken here, media stories, but if you take more like some more internet-related things, like it could be all the captions, labels of images, or if you have a video, you can use automatic speech for... can we learn the meaning of the words from these collections? And can we infer what, if we take documents, what are they speaking about, what their contents, if there's different words, what is the relations between words? And in particular, some aspects that is to say, okay, like, can we capture a polysemy? Like, the same words can be used to mean different things. For instance, if you speak as a bank, it could be the institution, it could be a building, it could be the bank of a river. So is it possible, if I have text, to actually differentiate these different meanings based on what I see in the documents, right? And similarly, there are some words that can mean more or less the same thing. Like, for instance, in a research paper, speak about the method, the approach, and so on, and maybe they refer to more or less the same aspect. So is it possible to actually derive that from analyzing like sets of documents? And of course, the goal is to know, okay, if I do this analysis, and after if I take documents, can I have a kind of summary of what they are about? So this translates into some kinds of research questions and processing tasks, let's say. So how to represent documents and the data knowledge and relationship between all this information and the words. If we have documents, how can we cluster documents, which might be quite sparse? So for instance, documents with only 200 words, and the vocabulary might be 10,000, 20,000 words. So it's very sparse. So if you do like computation or correlation, might be not very good and maybe a bad indicator. Can we find similarity between words, which is actually a very important topic in text analysis? Because obviously we are not in a metric space. We have a word, you know, it's just an index, and you have another word, it's just an index. So actually the goal is, can we put some kinds of ontology on top of this, or can we find information that could provide some relation between words? And of course, there's lots more things about that. And some of the techniques that were starting in the... in the 19th was latent semantic indexing or analysis, and still this is a book like that was like from 2006. And so starting from the representation of a document as a term by document matrix N, so if you have a matrix where each entry is the number of times a word W occurs in a document D, this method tried to do some matrix decomposition of the matrix. And what it tries to find, okay, words which occur a lot. And this decomposition, what it does, I will be a bit more detailed later, it's a list of topics which are shared by documents. At least this is what the aim. And if you think at co-occurrence analysis, this is really something that it's closer to actually PCA, principal component analysis. So if you want some dimensionality reductions, you can use classically like PCA, right? And what is used in PCA is correlation. And here in topic models, because you have set of words, you know, you cannot apply correlation. So what you do, the equivalent you kind of say is the co-occurrence. And this is more or less what topics are trying to capture and the topic models. This coming back to latent semantic analysis, it's working like on matrix decomposition, so it's an algebraic view, so which has some limitations. So what topic models I'm going to present is a kind of probabilistic view of these things. And the first method that was actually introduced, it was in 98 by Hoffman, which was called probabilistic latent semantic analysis, and I will go a bit, more in details really later. And what do we gain by using like the probabilistic approach over like the matrix decomposition? So one of the first elements is that you have a probabilistic model. So if you learn something from your data collection, if you are given a new document, you can do inference on these documents. You can predict whether it has more chances to belong to the collections or not, how it is structured, and so on. So this is an important aspect. You can model uncertainty about the elements which occur in the documents. It's actually much more flexible to include other informations when you do the analysis. So if we look at PLSA and LSA, it's actually quite close in some sense. But PLSA, if after we will see some example, if you want to add more variables to capture more relations between different types of information, it's much more flexible. And because it's based on probabilistic models and graphical models, of course, there's lots of research around that, well-defined algorithms for inference, learning, and so on, which is also quite an important aspect of the problem. And is actually being applied in many ways beyond text, as I will illustrate. So this is the outline of the talk. So in the first part, I will just give an overview of topic models, so really going into the basic of PLSA, a bit of introduction about graphical models, just to put some refresher, describe the model and provide some examples of application, and some other extension of the model. And in second part, I will describe more like techniques to use that for video analysis. So, okay, so just a basic digression. So how if you have a set of sentences, for instance, in a document, right? The dog chased the cat. You can represent this as a sequence, which is an ordered set of elements, right? And there might be duplicates. The is repeated here in these cases, right? After, you can say, okay, define a set, which in our case might be the vocabulary, what we call the vocabulary. So essentially, you only take all the individual items of all your documents, and you represent that, yeah, as a set, so they are unique, and there is no order there, right? I mean, just a set of elements, discrete. And the bags, which are going to be at the basis of many of these topic models, it's unordered, and there might be possible duplicates, and you can represent it in two ways. Either you just put this as a list, right, cat, chase, dog, the, etc. But the order doesn't mean it's just a list of all items, maybe. But because there are some repetition, you can represent this as histograms. So depending on the articles you are looking at, sometimes they use this and sometimes they use this. You will see that the way we represent it, often we represent the models with as lists, a set of words. But after, when we do inference, often, and we go to the maths, usually we use this notation. Okay, so words. I'm not sure you know that. I would imagine so. But essentially, if you have some documents like this, the dog chased the cat, you take all the elements. You need your vocabulary here, right? All the words that can occur in the document. So you take them and you put in the bag. And this is this aspect. It's an order. It's just a set of elements, right? And the frequency. And here, this is the two representation I talk, right? This is a bag, what I call the list with an order, or the histogram case, right? And of course, you can do that if you have a first document, a second document, a third document. You can use that to represent your information in the document collection. So for topic models, I mentioned LSA, so there's a matrix view. So the goal is to define documents as linear combination of topics. And because we are speaking about like values which are integers, counts, right, we try to have non-negative terms, right? So, but essentially it is like, okay, I have a document and I want to express this document as a linear combination where the coefficients are here and of different topics, right, which captures some words here, and here you have a list of topics, right? And obviously you want to do that for the first document, and you want to have the same for the second document, where a linear combination of the topics, and what remains and is the same is that you like the topics to be common to all documents, right? So this is what LSA is doing, and trying to do matrix decomposition, so of this problem, trying to decompose documents as linear combinations of topics. And essentially, there is some ways that if you have such a matrix, you can decompose into some topics. And here you have some kind of diagonal matrix. And here you have the coefficients for each of the documents. So, I mean, this is, I'm not going to speak more about it, but you can, these are some results from algebra. And it's also related to non-negative matrix factorization, because here we want the terms to remain non-negative. So what PLSA does is to add the probabilistic interpretation. And so whenever we take the documents, we are not going to represent them by counts, but like more probability distribution of words for documents. So we are normalizing this by the number of words in the documents. Distribution is a combination of the topics here, which will be defined as probabilities that the words occur in a given topics. Right. This, so the numbers here, we'd have some meetings in terms of probabilities. And P of ZD would be the coefficients, right? What is the probability that a topic occur in the document, right? And obviously here, this is independent of the documents. So this will be common to all documents versus here, this represents the part that is related to documents. So, because we are speaking about probabilistic model, we can use like sampling methods. So there is a kind of generative view of the problem. So we have documents, we have the bag of words, the list of words. So how can we sample a word from the document, right? What is a with risk representation? So essentially, well, if we distribution words for documents, which is what its inputs, you say if I want to sample a word, I just go, it's a multinomial distribution, and I just sample a word, and I will get some an example of a document which is represented by this distribution. But obviously, in the topic model, we introduce some additional information which are the topics. So how it goes is that essentially, as I mentioned, we have the topics which are multinomial distribution of a word, so you assume that they are given, with, and their probability for each word and so on. And the documents, as I mentioned, is a mixture of the topics. So it's, you have a representation like this. This is like, okay, this document is composed like with a higher probability with first topic, with less probability the second, and there is not so much elements from the third, and then it's from the fourth, right? So, and then if you do sampling, essentially what you do is first you select, if you want to draw a word, the first thing you do is you select a topic according to the distribution of topics in the document, and then once you have the topic, then you draw a corresponding word for the corresponding table representing the topic. And this is a generative of the problem. And this can be represented like with a graphical model like this. And so there that I'm going to make a small digression because I'm not sure how you are fluent with this type of representation. So and speak about like graphical models. Which has been described as, you know, like with graphs, like as a kind of marriage because between probability theory and graph theory, right? And this is a probabilistic graphical models. And it's quite some interesting aspects that we started like at the end of the 90s. And this actually was quite powerful because the two communities were, you say, more or less separated. And by joining the forces, let's say, were things from statistics or probability that were really rediscovered using results from the graphs and so on. And in addition, I mean, this representation actually provides a nice visualization tool for representing distribution. And in particular, so the goal of one element, important element of these models is to represent just joint distribution with graphs. So you have a set of random variables, so with nodes, which represent variables, parameters. So nodes have parents or children. And the goal of this is to represent joint distribution over this set of random variables. And here you introduce essentially some structures and dependencies between variables. So one of the fundamental results of graphical models is that the variable, which is composed of here seven variables, is as a product of local conditional probabilities, right? So here, we, if you have seven, which is equal to the, so the probability of X is equal to the probability of each of the variables just given its parent, right? And so, for instance, in this example, here we see that x1, x2, x3 have no parents. So you can say this is just probability of x1 times probability of x2 times probability of x3. But if you take x4, it has three parents, which is x1, x2, and x3. So it's probability of x4 given the value of x1, x2, and x3, and so on for the other nodes, right? And The interesting aspect of this is that, it, of course, it gives you some visualization of the dependency. But the structure that you use by representing these dependencies actually introducing a set of conditional independence between variables given other variables. And actually, there is quite a close relationship between the structure of the graph and the set of all conditional independence you can have between variables. So it's not an exact correspondence, but there is quite some relation. So for instance, here, if you look at this model, you can say that if I know the value of x4, the probability of x6 and x7 are independent. So they are conditionally independent given x4. So probability of x6 and x7 given x4 is equal to the probability of x6 given x4 times the probability of x7 given x4, which we can implicitly understand from the graph is that if I know the value of x4, if I'm changing the value of x6, here this will not have any influence on x7. Right? But if I would not know the value of x4, let's say it's random, then actually if I would change x6, that would influence the probability of having x7 in the graph, right? So essentially, beyond this, I mean, that's also a nice element of this representation. This is like by just looking at the graph, you can actually find what are the dependencies between variables depending on other variables. And obviously, so the factorization that is induced by your graph is simplifying the model, right? I mean, rather than having a joint distribution of all variables, here you have only to model local conditional probability. So in terms of parameters, you have less parameters to model these tables of probability or these probabilities, depending the form you have. So this is good for learning and inference, right? I mean, it's going to be easier to do both. But of course, you should always think that by doing this, you are making assumptions, and you have always to think, okay, are they valid? Does it make sense? And so on, right? So you should never forget that there is assumption behind that. So one quick element that is actually used a lot in topic models, when if you take any articles on topic models, that they first by say, this is a generative model. We have graphs, we have probability distribution, so we are able to sample elements, right? As I described with the text. And so a paper on topic models, you say they show you like a graph like this, and they tell you how you generate elements in this graph, right? This is a way to introduce all the elements of what is the model is composed of. So here, if you have a representation like this, essentially, if you want to generate a sample of the 7 variables, so a sample of x, very simple, you can only sample a variable if when the parents are known. And which means that, for instance, in this case, if I want to generate one sample of x, I can start with x1 because there is no parent, x2, x3. And then to sample x4, I will freeze x1, x2, and x3 according to the samples I got. And then I can sample x4. Right? And this is a way to generate. And if you repeat that, you get actually samples from your distribution P of x. Right? So this is an important aspect. Just one notation that is used as you show in the graph, so it's a plate notation. So essentially, in lots of cases, you have these bags, right, which are like elements which are like of the same nature, right? The way they are generated, they are all generated the same because there is no differences between them. So here it's illustrated in this way. So if you have a distribution over like a set of t variables, given some w parameters, here we don't care, it factorizes as this, the probability of w times the product over each of these nodes given the parents, which is w. And here, this distribution is the same for all I, right? So rather than keeping a graph like this, which is quickly visually cluttered, so what we do is actually we use these plate notations that here I put the node for w, and here I put a node for tn, right? And because it's repeated, I put a plate which says it's repeated, and here I say, okay, this is repeated n time. And sometimes people put as well the index that is used to represent this, because you may have like multiple plates overlapping. And then to finalize about this graphical model, so there are two main tasks with this the distribution and graphical model. So given a probability distribution, which is parameterized by a set of parameters, right? I mean, all these local conditional probabilities, they are probabilities. If it's a good, you have the covariance matrix and so on. If it's a multinomial, so you will have the multinomial parameters. So the first thing you want to do is, given some training data, so a set of values for observed node, estimate the parameters of the different probability, local conditional probability distribution, right? So this is the first task. And the second that you have is that assume that the parameters are known. If I know some of the variables, here, for instance, the blue ones, can I infer what is the probability of the latent or observed ones, which are, for instance, here, the ones which are not in blue, right? And these are the two main elements. And actually, in Bayesian frameworks, people say actually there's no difference between learning and inference because somehow you can put the parameters as nodes. And when you actually infer your parameters, you actually, when you're actually learning your parameters, it's like doing an inference of nodes, which are your hidden variable, let's say. And and the interest I speak is that, of course, for learning and inference, given the type of structure you consider, there's lots of algorithms, generic algorithms to do learning and so on. And, but I'm not going to speak about that here. So now if we come back to our problem, so we have these documents. We just saw the way to generate that. And this model is represented by this graphical model. So essentially here, so you see that there are two plates, right? We have three plates, actually. So what do we have here? So first, here in, I will make a distinction between two types of nodes here. Three types, but the ones which are variables and the ones which are the parameters, right? The way it's represented here. So here we have, we see that we have two plates, right? One is because we have a set of documents, and here, because for each document, we have a set of words, right? So they are interlaced, right? So in terms of variables, so essentially what we have is for each document D, we have ND pairs of variables, right? XDI and ZDI, so D would mean the index of the document, and I is the index of the word in the document. The word usually will be the observations, right? I have a document, I know which words are in my document. And Z represents this latent topic. It's a latent variable which corresponds to these words is coming from which topic, right? If you remember in the generative process, I first say I'm selecting a topic, and then given this topic, I generate a word. So essentially here, for each word, we will associate a variable which corresponds to this topic. And then in this model, we will consider that we have parameters, and the parameters here are represented with as nodes, even if here this means, they are considered as parameters, so there's no probability involved on those at this moment. So for each topic, and we have k topics, right? So that's why we have a plate. We have the probability table of the probability of observing a word given the topic. And here, for each document, we have theta, right, theta d, which is the probability of observing topics given this document, right? So this is elements I introduced earlier. And this is a generative process. So if I consider my random variable, so essentially I need to generate all these variables here. And here it's very simple. It's, here the parent is z. So first what I do is I sample z given theta, right? I sample the topic, and then if I want to sample x, it's depend. I take a sample of a word given the topic and given the list of topics, right? That's why there's these two arrows here, which with the plate, which means that to sample these words, I need to know z and the list of topics, right? And here this is how it goes, right? I mean, here you sample z di, and x di is actually coming from the topics. By the topic distribution indexed by the sample topics. So, okay. So there are two tasks, inference and learning. So here, just to speak about quickly about the inference task. So here, something that is easy to identify is that given the parameters, so if I know theta, if I know phi, all these pairs are actually independent, right? Which means that if I know the parameters of my distributions, right? If I know a word and it, this is not going to have any influence. Another Because I know all the information is captured by these parameters, so given the parameters. So if I want to do inference, now if I have a word, I would like to know what are the probable topics which could have generated that document, right? So what is the probability of ZDI given XDI? And here, because essentially I normally should condition on all the rest, but because here it's conditionally independent, it's just very simple. So you can just use Bayes' rules. And using Bayes' rules, you can see that this is equal to the probability of X given Z times the probability of the variable ZDI, which says that this is the probability of the topic in the document is a product of two terms. It's quite easy. Which was the first one says, how strong is the word, or how probable is the word in the topic, right? Which is going to be important if I want to know where the word is coming from, but also how strong is the topic Z in the document, right? So it's not only if I want to know what the probability of the topic given the words, I'm not going to look only at the probability tables of topics. I'm also here, I am in a document, and so what is the document is about, which as we will see later means what are the other words in the document, because they will influence which topics we are in, how strong they are. Will have an influence of what is the topic that potentially generated this variable. And somehow this is going to be related to the polysemy aspect, right? If I have a word, it's going to depend of, okay, what this document is talking about? And this is how I can affect the word to different topics. Now, if we look at the aspect of learning now, so we have observed variables, so we have our latent variables which are known. The set of parameters we need to know are of these theta, so the documents topic proportions and the topics. So we can do classical likelihood estimation, so we like maximize the likelihood or the log likelihood of the data here, which is given by this expression. And as you can see here, we have a mixture model, right? I mean, a document is a mixture of documents. So if you have done EM algorithm with mixture of Gaussian, so here everything goes more or less similarly. Right, so here you have in the log you have a sum, so obviously you cannot separate each of these terms. So to actually optimize this, you can go and use, for instance, a maximization algorithm. So just to give again the intuition of this algorithm, so essentially assume that the parameters are known. So if the parameters are known, then it would be easy to infer Z. This is just what I described previously, right? I can compute probability of Z, DI for the given words, right? So, but this assumes that the parameters are known, and now I'm trying to do learning. So I have a kind of chicken and egg problem. That I would know all the variables, assume that I would know the words, but I would know the topic it's coming from, right? Which is a good case, all variables are observed. So if I would do estimation, maximum likelihood estimation of my parameters, it's very easy. How many times a word was associated with a given topic in my document, right? And similarly, for the topics, I just need to see, for each word, I know from which topic, so I just take the words which are associated with this topic, and I compute just the statistics, and I get this, right? And indirectly, what EM is doing is kind of iteration between those two tasks, so assuming that I have some parameters, I'm going to be able to infer the latent variable given the observed variable. And then in the M step, I will actually maximize I will estimate a new version of my parameters given these latent variables. And because implicitly I have the distribution over latent variable, when I do this optimization, it's almost like if I have weighted observations where I know for each X what is the corresponding Z. I'm not going to go more into the details, but this is how it works. So in PLSA, what is the interpretation of what? So let's look at a basic illustrative examples where we have three words. So and then we assume that we have inferred two topics, right? So obviously, we have these three words. We can define distribution over these three words, right? And which corresponds to the space of word distribution, which is called a simplex because so there are some coordinates, and any point in this triangle is the sum of coordinates sums to one, right? And here, because my document is a distribution about words, so my documents are a point in this space, And similarly, my topics are a distribution of awards, so there are also points in this space, right? And whenever I model documents as normalized linear combination of topics, what I'm saying is that if I have my two topics, my model says that I can generate distribution of awards which are elements of the simplex formed by these two topics. So here, because I have only two topics, if I change the proportion of the topics, I'm going to move from here to here and there, right? So what I'm doing during learning, essentially, it's that I have observed documents, which are the white dots. And during learning, I'm trying to fit my model, so my topics and topics proportion, so that the fit is better, so that I place my topics in the right place, so that if I say I project a white point to its to the simplex of topics, they are close enough. But the close is in a likelihood sense. You would use, for instance, you would say you are trying to minimize the reconstruction error, right? But here it's more like you do a fit, but it's in likelihood, so it's not the distance between the point here and there. So speaking about PCA, so actually you can think of this process as a dimensionality reduction process, right? If you have the distribution of words for your documents, you can replace that by the probability of topics given the documents, right? And because usually the words might be 10,000, and maybe you can use 50, 100, or 200 topics. Essentially, this is how you can make a dimensionality reduction step in this case. Okay, so now to some examples. So if we want to apply PLSA for topic discovery, what do we need? So it's quite simple in practice. You need to define a vocabulary. And this is quite important because the way you define your vocabulary will define your semantic space. And you need a way to actually compute a bag of words representation given this vocabulary, right? So, and obviously, I mean, this is quite, when it comes to text, we see that when we take other types of data, we have to consider what you can learn. Depends on your aim. So the question is after, okay, I have documents, I have words, then I want to analyze my results. What can I do to analyze what I learned, right? Does it make sense? Does it not make sense? And so on. So because we have a probabilistic distribution, for topics are distribution of a word, so we can say, we can look at what are the important words for these topics, right? And if the words have some semantics, maybe this can be helpful to understand what a topic has captured. But this is not always useful. For instance, when we consider videos, sometimes the words might be something that may not, you know, strikes what the meaning may not be striking at the beginning. So the other aspect is that you have documents which are distribution over topics. So here to actually analyze this, what you can do is you have your topics here, and you know this is a simplex made by the topics, and the projection, let's call them like this, so the fitted models are lying in this space, right? So if I want to analyze what the first topic has captured, what I can do is I can try to find the documents where the probability of the topic one is very important, because by looking at all these documents, maybe I get a sense of what is this invariance among those documents, and what is invariance will correspond to probably what the topic one characterizes, right? Of course, if I have documents for which the probability of topic one is one, I visualizing it directly tells me more or less what the topic is about. But sometimes your documents may only lie here, right? So because documents are a mixture of topics, and there is no guarantee that there are documents for which the probability of topic one is important. So to do that, an easy way is actually just to rank the documents according to the mixture weight. So if I have topic one, I can look at the probability of topic one on all documents, and I rank them by these values, and then I will get the topics which are closer to the topic. And if you have documents, maybe you have metadata about them, you have labels, for instance, when it comes to images and so on, so you can look at what is the correlation between the tags and the topics, right? Or, for instance, if you are using the theta representation, you can use it for further tasks, for instance, for classification. So you can see whether your projection. Somehow your presentation is better than the back-of-words distribution if you do a classification task, right? So, okay, so some examples. So if we take text document, I mean, it's quite easy. The vocabulary is just a set of words. The documents are the bag of words. So here, this is an example taken from Stavers and Griffiths. So it was applied at 37th passage from educational material. And so what we see here is 4 out of the 300 topics. And here you see the first one is about drugs, drug medicine, effects, body medicine, pain, persons, marijuana, label, alcohol, dangerous, abuse, effects, and so on. And then also the second one, you see it's mainly related to colors and so on. So here it's about doctor, patient, hospital, care, medical nurse, and so on. So you see that the co-occurrence analysis has been able to, you know, provide topics where we can more or less understand what has been captured, right? Because it's semantic, the words are text, right? So we can more or less give some names, right? Here might be drug use, here might be related to colors, here might be memory and mind, here might be visit to doctors or something related to hospitals. And what we can see is that it has been able to capture synonymy. Here, the most obvious case is that between singular and plurals, you often see the names, right? So here, for instance, you have a medicines and a nurse and nurses and so on. So if you have not do some text analysis like stemming or whatever, here it's automatically recovered. So it's been handled by the model. But obvious like other more like synonymy physician and doctor might be considered as being maybe more related, depending on the context, it might be interchanged. And it handles polysemy or the context use, although here in this example is not so obvious. There is no obvious case here where, you know, the same words appear in both, and actually it means really different things. So, and of course, here the names of topics are just artificial. It's just your interpretation of what's there. And you can look at documents. So, for instance, if you look at document proportions, so here you say, okay, this is your document proportion. So it's the first, and this is a high proportion for this one, and here this is a less proportion for this one. So maybe you can say, oh, this document is about, I don't know, a person experiencing a loss of memory, right? And who needs to go to the doctor, goes to the doctor, right? I mean, that might be the type of interpretation you may have by just looking at this. You can do the same with other types of course, document repository, and obviously you will get other topics with different types of context. So if you only take law journals, you will end up with different things, right? Some more related to taxes, some more like to laborers, employees, and so on. So maybe the working conditions or the laws about works and so on. Here might be more related to family and so on, right? So it's important. And here I'm not going to describe, but here you have the most probable words, and here to the right, this is how much a word is actually very specific to that topic. Because words can be very probable, but maybe some words might be very probable for all topics. So they don't contain really discriminatory power. So you can also look, like in text, at which words are very specific to a given topic using a TF-IDF analysis. So let's consider a second example, which comes from, okay, like cell phone data, right? So I have my cell phone, and my data are registered all during the whole day. And I'm able to cluster whenever I'm at work or whether I'm at home or I'm at other locations. I don't know, I have not classified them. Or sometimes there's no way, there's no transmission, so I don't know where I am, right? And so here, if you have like, there was some experience that was done in Lausanne where during like 12 months or 1 year, people were having some software running, and essentially this type of data was collected. So here you have the days of all people, you know, and all days, all their days. And the goal is, okay, can we try to identify some patterns out of these data about where people are going, at what time, and so on? Right? And because here, this, at any moment, so you discretize the time into 48 slots of half an hour, where you take kind of majority vote. And after, you can say, well, you have this label at any moment. Now, if you want to analyze, you cannot do correlation because, again, the labels, you cannot correlate them directly, like as a vector. Essentially, what you'd like to use is co-occurrence, right? if the goal is to find the daily routine patterns, we have to define the vocabulary, how we define our documents, and apply the model. So for the vocabulary, rather than keeping this discretization, the time will be further discretized into four time slots, from 0 to 7, from 7 to 9, from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m., and so on. And respect to the content, the word will be 3 grams of location. And ultimately, a word will be a 3 gram plus the time slots in which it dominantly occurs. So here, for instance, H1 means it's mainly the person has been at home for 3 time periods, so 1.5 hours, and before 7 a.m. dominantly. Right? So it may have some overlaps at 7:30, but mainly during this period. So you have a vocabulary size of like 4 to the power 3. And then if you want to build the documents, you just take one day of one person. And then you are just going to learn what is the routines across person. So at this point, we are not going to introduce what is the specific daily routines of a given person. Right? But this could be done with, for instance, one of the models I will be introducing later. So this is the type of results that you obtain. So here, as I mentioned, you can look at what are the most probable words, right, which occurs in this topic, for instance, or in this topic. And here you can look at the documents, and you can consider what is like more or less always the same in all these documents, right? So we see here that there is almost yellow here, there is some kinds of this light blue here, and then a bit of red, and here we see it's more random. So probably what this topic is about is commuting home to work. So here we are at home, here we are somewhere else, and here in red we are at home. But here it says nothing. Here it's just, again, because the document is a mixture of topics. So, of course, all these documents are represented also by other topics, right? But what is common, what seems to be common to all these ones seems to be like this part. And here it's more a bit the same, although when you look at it, it's a bit more confusing. But if you look at the probability of words, it seems that it's more like being outside during the day and at home late afternoon, early evening. So you have a kind of others here, it's less clear, and more like yellow on the right. Versus here, you have more change, different types of things. And of course, because all days are annotated by the day of the week they have been registered in, you can see that this type of documents corresponds like more to week elements, right, from Monday to Friday. Whereas here, this one, you see that this topic is quite high during the weekends, which is why, well, maybe the less structure, right? Because during the weekends, you may not have like a fixed schedule, things may be more varying. Let's go now to topics in images. So text modeling approaches have been quite applied to scene modeling and to image processing. I mean, bag of words techniques have been actually quite powerful over the, let's say, last 10 years. I mean, recently, I mean, with the deep neural nets, I mean, this is a bit changing, but they were one of the most powerful techniques to actually do classification and inference. So essentially, given a set of images, you want to compute a bag of words representation of this content. And then you can apply essentially probabilistic latent technique to do classification, clustering, segmentation, or annotation. So I will briefly overview this element. So given an image, and that was actually a bit like what José was representing, but for robots. So what you can do is you can extract automatically some salient points of this image, which is interest point detector. And in each of these yellow regions, you can compute a descriptors, which might be sift, which might be lots of other things, which, for instance, in the case of sift, has 128 dimension, right? And here we use interest points, and that was actually quite common at the beginning of the year 2000. After, to have more powerful representation, people thought, okay, let's forget about the salient points, just compute, do a dense sampling of your grid. So you just do a dense sampling at every point in the image, you compute a descriptor at different scales, right? And this is actually much more powerful as a representation. So then what you want to do is build the vocabulary. So what do? Is you take a set of images, like landscape, cities, you extract your interest points, you extract your descriptors, and then you do k-means, and you use 1,000, 2,000 words, and then you obtain a vocabulary, and to, for instance, look at what this k-means represents, you can look at samples which are associated with the corresponding cluster center. So, for instance, you have like, okay, this is a kind of this local contents that, that are associated with the number one. And here, this is another type of content that is associated with number two, right? And so we see that the words correspond more or less to local patterns, right? And maybe by looking at them, you may have an idea about where they are coming from in the image, right? So now, if you have a set of images, you can compute your bag of words. Is that you just take your samples, your computing, you quantize them, and then you just count how many times they occur, right? And obviously here, we see that this special information is totally discarded, right? So which is the same as the bag of words representation, where you remove the order. So obviously, there's some kind of, let's say, synonymy. If I look at the number 15 and 427, we have the feeling that more or less they are representing the same. Probably there is some slight variation between them, but probably here they are quite similar, right? At the same time, here, if we look at one of elements like this, we have some patterns, and we see some corresponds to some texture, might be found in nature, in trees, and so on, but some are correspond coming more from buildings, some structural element. So this word may occur, you know, at the different types of content, right? So it may mean different things depending on the type of images it is in. So the goal is, can we disambiguate the representation from bag of words? And what we try to use is to say, okay, maybe we can look at the corpus information and use actually PLSA, right, to do this. So then, as we've seen, we have our bag of words, and doing this decomposition, we decompose an image into a linear combination of different topics, right? So, and then to do the analysis of what has been learned, we can do ranking the image according to the probabilities that a topic is occurring in that image, or we can look at the important words in those topics. So let's look at the first element. So we look at what are the important images which corresponds to topic four. And we can see that mainly it comes from cities with a bit of textures like this, right? Some windows and so on. And this is what I've been captured. If I look now at topic three, definitely it's not the same type of content that has been captured. It's difficult to know exactly where it's coming from, but this is a type of analysis. So it's really landscape, and it's nature, but there's often like a kind of sky with some skylines and so on, whether it comes from lakes or some other place like this. And there is a bit of mix of different things, like maybe trees and so on. If I take the topic six, we see it's another type of landscape that has been captured. There is less sky, more texture, right? Whether it's from fields or whether it's from mountains and so on, right? So it really captured different things. And because we have the labels of the images, we can actually use them to do precision recall curves. So if I take these images and I look at the elements which are important, if I do my ranking, I can take, okay, out of the 10 first, how many are cities? And I compute the precision. So if I take more images, I can compute how many corresponds to cities. So maybe if the 10th corresponds to city, I will be at one, right? And here you see that there are some topics which are actually highly correlated with cities. The precision, if you take almost all images from your databases, like 50%, the first 50% of your images are only cities and no landscape. And for the landscape, you see it's a bit less the case. You see that it doesn't stay like this at one, but it goes smoothly like this. But obviously, you see that some topics are quite related to landscape versus some really are really quickly dropping. So maybe at the beginning, the first images are typical of landscape, but after, it's more mixed. So the other possibility is to say, okay, in a given image, I have a word, right, which is XI. And I would like to know it comes from which topic, right? So to analyze. So for this, I compute the probability of the topics given the words, which, as we've seen, is a product of two terms. So how strong is the word so in the topic? So is this an important word for the topic? But also, is this topic important for that image, right? Which means that it's related to polysemy disambiguation, and it introduces some context. What a word means here, a local pattern, is depending on the other words. Because if I have a lot of words from city, probably the topics related to city will be important. So if I want to interpret these patterns, where it's coming from, it's probably I will select topics where this word is important, but more I will select those where also relates more to city. Right? And obviously, then if I have identified topics with kinds of, you know, the topic 4 was more man-made and 6 was more nature. So if I look at this allocation of words to topics, I see here that the ones that were allocated to the number 4 corresponds more like to man-made structures, versus the red ones correspond more like to, let's say, kind of trees and so on. And I can do this, right? I can take an image, I get the points, I extract the topics representations, and then if I look at the most probable ones, which ones are associated with that? So we have the reds, which is it's more like in the structure. The 6 is more like in the trees. The other one, we see it's more like as well other types of textures. And I can do the same for other images like this. And here it's quite interesting. So it's topic 12 is also quite related, you know, to man-made elements. And here, it's this one, I like it, because you see that all the words correspond like from kinds of skyline type of local content, right? Because before you say, okay, this is textures versus non-texture, regularity, and so on. But this one, I think it's quite interesting. And then you can do similar things like this. Okay, let's look at some of this. So first, going back to PLSA. So PLSA is not fully generative. So in the sense that in my model, I assume that these were parameters, although I put them in nodes, and they are not random variables, which means that this multinomial, what is the probability of topics within a document, they are parameters. So for known D, we have a generative process. If I have a known document, I can generate the words. But now if I'm telling you, how do I generate a new document? Well, I don't know, because here these are my parameters. And of course, if I know them, I can do it. But how do I generate these parameters? I don't know. So I need a way to generate the multinomials corresponding to the documents, right, to make it really fully generative. So which means that I need to consider the multinomial parameters as random variables, right? So looking back at my illustration, like the space of distribution of words. So I have my topics, and the topic proportions, which is theta d, are points in this simplex of topics, right? So which means that if there are points here, I need to model a distribution over this simplex, right? Which means that okay, here are points. How probable is this point? How probable is this, which corresponds to this multinomial? And so the common example to model distributions, or classical way of modeling a distribution over these topics, is to use Dirichlet distributions, which are characterized by a set of parameters alpha, and the probability of a point, which corresponds to topic proportion, is given by, let's say, this expression, right? And if you have some examples, depending on the parameters you use, if you assume they are all equal, so if you use a value below 1, you say it will favor like a sparse probability. So it's highly probable that I will have parameters which are very localized around topics or in between. If it's 1, then I will have a uniform distribution. And then if I use higher values and all the same, it will be more probable that I will distributions which are a bit of everything, right? And obviously, I can select alpha values, and depending on the alpha values, I can bias, you know, these distributions to more or less towards different topics by selecting different alpha values. And because it's a distribution, then given my parameters, my distribution, I can sample proportions, right? So this is the latent Dirichlet allocation model. Here we have added priors on the document multimodules. So here we introduce this alpha parameters that represent the parameter of the Dirichlet. And here we actually do the same. I mean, the topics are multinomial distribution over words. So we can actually also have a prior on how to generate a topic model, right? And so in this case, we have a fully generative model. So we can generate new documents and words in documents. The introduction of this allows to do to smooth the inferred topics, so there is no words that get zero probability, so during inference it's better. And then the of course, the model is a bit different than PLSC, so a different scheme. You can still use EM, but there are other elements. And often in topic model, I mean, one of the way to do inference is using Markov chain Monte Carlo GIP sampling. Then if we look at another extension, if we look at this model, one typical issue, it's a mixture model, right? A mixture of topics, like mixture of Gaussian. One typical issue is how many Gaussians do you select? How many topics do you select? And here, also another aspect that is a limitation of the LDA is that there's words which are, okay, yeah, so it's not a correct word. It's stop, should be, need to remove stop words. There are some words that occur a lot, and during the inference process, you have, in the likelihood, you try to give a lot of importance to those words. So they are going to really bias estimates so that they are well fit, although they may not contain necessarily the best information. So to handle these two issues, you can rely on hierarchical Dirichlet processes, so not distribution, but processes. And here, as a quick way of representing it, maybe if I have time, I will present in the second part a bit more about it. So it's non-parametric methods, which allows to model distributions over distributions. And it's a way to have clean ways of having infinite models. So here, as you can see here, what changed between this and this is that here, instead of saying I have k, here I can potentially I can have an infinite number of topics, right? And here, whenever I have some alpha value here, I can generate different, it's not multinomials, because here beta and theta may have an infinite number of weights. Because if I have a potentially an infinite number of topics, I should have proportion potentially for all of them. So, and this vector might be infinite, right? But so this is a good formalism to do that. And in practice, when you have actual data, of course, you never get an infinite number of topics, but it tends to cluster elements. But if you have more observations, it will select a given number of topics. So it's another way to selection, which relies on these elements. And also it addresses the other drawbacks. Maybe to conclude this first part, just to show how you can extend this model to add other variables, right? Because right now it was mainly LDA. I generate a topic, I generate a document. So here this is the autotopic model that was introduced. So let's say if you have articles, and articles are written by multiple authors, right? And you would like to know what is the speciality of a given authors. Right? Obviously, you cannot just take the document of that authors. If you have all documents for a set of authors, you can do this. So this is a graphical model. So here you say, okay, you find actual topics, right, which are independent of authors. So you have documents which are still a list of words. And as I was saying, essentially, if you take the corresponding paper, you get this, and they say how you sample elements. And after, you think how you do make inference and so on. So here how it's done. So first, if you have a set of authors, the first thing you say, you select an author. And given an author, then you are going, so which is this variable x. And then given these authors, you are going to choose a topic, but given the authors. So here we have introduced new, let's say, tables, which K represent, you have K authors, which are, you know, multinomial distributions over topics for each of the author, right? And so now the Z are going to be sampled, not only based on the document, but on the authors that may correspond to that, right? And essentially the learning aspect is that given papers, list of words, and the corresponding authors, how you can infer this type of tables. And if you are able to infer that, so you will be able to, the topics might be related to different semantics elements, and then you will know that an authors have actually a distribution over those topics, right? So you see that here, it's, and this, that would be very difficult to do with matrix manipulations, let's say like latent semantic analysis. So here it's easy to add variables which corresponds to what you want to model. Of course, the difficulty that may come is how do we make inference, how do we make learning, which is something different. So, good. So topic models are bag of words. It's a way of doing unsupervising mining of themes or activities. It's based on concurrence analysis. And it's probabilistic, so it's quite flexible. It models uncertainties. It can predict probabilities for new elements. And it can be applied to different types of elements. So, okay, so that's the end of the first part. Still have minutes for the second part. I don't know if there's any question at this point. Within the time frame of 5 seconds, what occurs, of course, spans more information about trajectories. So we still get elements about trajectories, but here we have no information that when we are here, it's element starts here and here. Right? It's just a back of words within these 5 seconds. So we lost some information. If we increase information, we may start to have like occurrence of things, right? Because within 5 seconds, there are lots of things to happen. So it starts to be more difficult to define what's actually really co-occurring because there is some meaning and what is just due to chance, right? So people have tried to introduce those models to introduce temporalization with topic models. So here, this is an example of Bly. So essentially here, you see the typical LDA type of approach with topic proportions and topic and words. And actually, what was introduced here is that the models that generates the topic proportions within the document at a given instance is modeled like with temporal dependencies, which means that this is going to smooth the alpha over time. And you will get different alphas over time. So the topic proportion will depend over time. And here, the same happens with the topics. So they will have a list of topics, but the priors on the topics will also be models over time. So here, in their cases, they applied this. For instance, they looked at a journal. I think it's a Royal journal, so from the Royal Society, over like 100 years. Are able actually to find topics, and after they can see the evolution of the topics over time. So this is the start of quantum physics, and so some of the topics that were really like you say it gives you some trends going on. So by looking at all the documents and if you index them by time. So here some people also propose some Markov clustering topic models. So here again you find like the words and the activities, and what they introduce is some states which are at the scene level. And essentially, these states are going to tell you how probable are a given topic at a given time instance, right? But still, these are global states, but the topics are still bag of words here, right? So there is no temporal information except that at a given time instance in the video, we are in that state, right? But there is no, the activities themselves are not models, the temporal information is not models. So here, this is the approach overview. So we are doing some processing to extract a temporal document, the matrix like number of times words occur at a given time instance. And then based on that, we are going to do some temporal model. So I will quickly go through the low-level processing. So it's like what we did before. So we take the video, we quantize, and then we apply PLSA. And what we are is to decide that these low-level topics are going to be our high-level words vocabulary. So each of these rows corresponds to one of these low-level topics I have shown before. And at a given time instance, the amount of high-level words is going to be given by the low-level topic probability at that time instance. And this way, I can generate these temporal documents that is for my temporal analysis. So this is the intuition behind the model. So if I have a video, I have these low-level topics, which corresponds to each row. And here, the red says, okay, what are the words, high-level words occurred at a given in time instant. So I can play the video, and essentially, there is activities going on. And depending on these low-level topics, whether they are becoming high or not, depending on whether they correspond to this topic, right? And this is my document that it unfolds over time. And I would like to find, actually, what are the patterns there, right? So if I look at specific elements in the sequence where I have a car coming from here to here, I mean, this is a type of trace that the car leaves in this, right? So I have no notion of orders here between the activities. And if I do another video with another car, I see that I get a trace which is quite similar. And if I would know I would take example of this several times. I would actually see, okay, here this is the temporal activity patterns corresponding to a car moving from here to here. What I'd like to infer, but in practice, I don't have these sequences. What I have is the first example where everything is mixed up. So this is the idea besides temporal modeling. So what I'd like is to find my patterns, and my patterns will be represented by what are the probabilities of words at a given time. So it will be a relative time. So if I have a pattern, so if I take a window of 20 seconds, if these patterns occur, I will know after 1 second what are the words which are occurring after 2 seconds, 3 seconds, and so on. And obviously, in order to model these documents, I would like to find when motifs are starting, right? To actually be able to generate this document. And the main point is that essentially what it does, it decomposes my temporal documents as a mixture of motifs, and we are jointly estimating the motifs and starting time. How much? 10 minutes or 10, 15? Okay, because we started quite later. So, okay. So this is how it works in terms. So this is a model corresponding to our approach. So where we observation here, you see we have like words, but also we have the. Assume we have the temporal, and you know when they occur. So how to generate a word in this matrix is very easy. So essentially, you sample in this generative process, you sample time, a motif occurrence. So given the time occurrence and the motif, you are going to select a word at a given time, relative time instance here. And based on these two types of information, you are going to say, okay, this corresponds to I'm generating a word here. Right, and this, I can do that several times, and ultimately, I should have a model to generate this matrix. And then, the inference corresponds to, I have these documents, and I try to learn automatically when the motifs and when they occur. And in the first step, let's say I did that by doing training, I'm getting a new video, I freeze the temporal motifs, and I can use that, for instance, to decide, okay, when are these activities occurring, so which I can find essentially the model to new documents. So maybe I'm going to skip that, but you can do some kinds of EM algorithms, similarly to what was done in the case of PLSA. You maximize data likelihood, and you go through, you compute for each word in the documents, you say, can it be explained by which motifs, which starts at which instance? Right, you get a distribution of that, and then in the MSTAT you are able actually to recompute the t-tables. Okay, so let's look at some example. So just a representation first. So this is actually what we learn. Here we have the relative time, and here we have the set of words. Right. So here, if we take, for instance, so at each time instance, I can look at what are the patterns there, and again, back project that to the image to understand what's captured. So here, this is the first column of this motif. So here, this is the second column. Here, this is, let's say, the third or fourth, and so on. And if I should display that, this is the type of activities that I'm able to capture. But I'm not going to show always GIFs like this. For visualization purposes, I can also show like a motif like this, where blue means it's at the beginning of the motifs, and green is at, let's say, at the middle, and red is more at the end of the activity. So here, if I take this video, we've seen with our cars and so on. So this is the motif that I was obtaining. So in this case, we were considering like 12-second maximum activities, right? Here it's not exactly with these PLSM models, but one Richler processes. So we know that these motifs explain 95% of our observations. So this is how we can actually also select the motifs to show. So what we can see is that some obviously we have traces of objects coming from here to here, and here from here to here. Here we have really like the different types of trajectories that can be taken by cars. And we have also like similar. So if you look at this and this one, you can see, oh, they look a bit the same. It starts here and it ends here. And the main difference here between these is that here you see it's bigger. So actually this model is more like trucks. because trucks occupy a larger part of the space, and usually when they turn, they are less close to the street, they tend to go a bit on the other sides, right? So also it's important here to see that implicitly we model like some synonymy, because some motions are similar. The motion here and here are the same, right? But we don't come from the same direction. So they're just explained by different topics depending on the context. So here, if we take this example, we it's quite well structured, so we get quite cleanly the activities which are co-occurring. So often, you know, when the light is changing here, it can go both ways. So that's why we have two types of trajectories. But the trams, they are moving usually independent of others, and it's the same for some cars turning. So here, we can see that this is quite well captured. Here, this is another example, so in another view, which is quite busy. So we have tram activities in this case, right, which are captured by the different topics. We have also some car activities, but again, here you can see that this looks quite similar, but essentially what's different is at the beginning, here it's when cars are coming here to go in this direction. Here these are cars coming from, there's another actually crossroads here, and here the topics actually start in this direction. So even if these last parts are actually similar, the beginning of the activities are actually, so and temporally, the model has captured that, right? Given the duration of our topics, so that because we allow the topics to last for 30 seconds. Of course, if we look at less structured data, so people, what they do is a bit less structured than cars, we can consider multiple cameras, right? Like in this case, we have cameras looking at the same space. So let's look at what we can get. Some interesting aspect, if we look at the first low level, right? So essentially here, what we do when we have multiple cameras is exactly the same. We just take the words of this and the words of this, you put them together, and you construct your documents, right? So there's no change, and then you look at what co-occurs. And the interesting aspect is that even looking at the PLSA, you see that here you are doing some kind of soft calibration. When something is happening here, there's often something happening in this region, right? And when something is happening here, it corresponds to this position, more or less, right? So essentially, we have not put any calibration information of the system, but just by observing and finding the co-occurrences, we are able to partition, let's say, the physical space into activities that corresponds actually to different locations. And not only to different locations, because behind, there's also motion words. Again, here, we just say the marginal overposition. So we may have actually topics like this, two topics like this, one when it goes this way, and one when it goes the other way. So now if we look at examples, so in this case, so these are the type of patterns we find. So lots of, here this is an underground station, so below a street, so often people come, go down, cross, and then go up to go to the other side of the street. So here we find some of these patterns, people coming from this side and going to the other side. Here we got the reverse activity. Here there are two vending machines. So here we see that people coming from the vending machines to the turnstiles. And here we get the patterns corresponding when people come from this vending machine to the other turnstiles. And here, again, activities, people arriving, going to the vending machines. Here you have people arriving from the sides and going through the turnstiles to enter the metro station. Here you have people coming actually from the other side and going through the turnstation. Here you have people coming from here and moving here because there are some escalators over on this side, so people go to the escalators and so on, right? You see that even in this case where the information is less structured, the model is able to capture activities. So this is another example where we have two cameras, and you see there's no overlaps between them, except that here some top of it is actually corresponding to some parts here. And you see that the model is actually saying that there's no correlation between what's going on here and here temporally. Right, so we are able to distinguish even if there is no overlap. And here in this case, we don't see the topic, but corresponding to people going up the escalator, turning around and going up. So here is our people coming like in groups, going down the escalators. Here we have like people on this view moving on the red side behind the pillar. And here we have people coming from our two main origins. So we get like the two origins. So you see, I mean, these are quite close. So the words may not mean, but just through the temporal modeling, actually, that look at the video where this is high, you could say, oh, this is a person coming from here, and this is a person coming from another position, or group of persons. Because here it's difficult to individualize, really, the information. And obviously, in our model, we lost all the speed information, so which means that in the temporal information, to move from here to here, some people may take different times, right? And essentially, this is means in our model, there is no notion of speed. So this has been captured here in this case by different patterns, essentially. This is why here it starts both with blue, but here it goes to green, which means here people are going slower, versus here after quickly they cross the place. And we can extend that. We can use more cameras, right? And in this example, this is a GIF. So here we take four cameras, like you recognize some of the ones I showed before. Here this one as well. And here this is one camera corresponding to something here. And this one corresponds to some camera below. And we just throw all the back of words. We do all this analysis. And we see that even here, this is just from 2 hours of data, which is actually not a lot. If you consider all the types of co-occurring information that may happen, not speaking about in that some of the topics, we end up the escalators are always moving, so they tend to co-occur with more or less everything, right? But here we see the same, exactly the same topic I just showed you before, but I add four cameras, so potentially more chances to actually confuse that things here are happening with respect to here and so on. Right? So, evaluation. So that was also one of the questions, you know, is it useful for later on and so on. So I will quickly go through it, but so to do that, we first try to generate synthetic documents to see the model is working, we capture elements we are interested in and so on. We have three ground truths, so it's good to first, you know, see whether our inference algorithm is working, and not always so trivial. We apply this to a large set of data which are used by the community to do this type of analysis, MIT, Queen Mary, ETH, or data. In the Van Ayn project we are working on, we had all this unstructured data where robust tracking is not always possible, and there's multiple camera. We also consider audio data with this model, I will quickly show. And then the tricky part is how to do quantitative evaluation. It's quite not so easy. So we can do prediction tasks and compare with other modeling methods. We have a probabilistic method, and we can potentially look at precision recall in some cases. So quickly, precision accuracy, you assume that you have given your documents up to a given moment and you try to predict the futures, and you can look at the likelihood of observations in the futures given what you have inferred so far, and then you can draw some graphs like this, and this is a typical kind of, let's say, perplexity or prediction likelihood, and then you can compare with other methods that have been produced. You can do anomaly rating, which is something that is quite interested, I mean, in the context of surveillance. And you can consider, so if you have at the given instance, you can say, is this video very likely, given what I have learned, the type of activities that I should observe? So there's different ways of, you can look, you people typically look more likelihood models, because we have probabilistic methods, but you could potentially as well look at reconstruction errors, right? You have an empirical probability of words, and your model tells you, is reconstructing this probability based on the model, so you can look at these differences. So here, this is just an example. What we get in the case of unstructured data is not always so meaningful. So here's just an example. So here we have some information. It's people going in multiple directions, which might not be so well modeled by the activities. Here are lots of people crossing each other. So people, instead of following, you know, straight routes, tends to go more into other direction, a bit to the left and so on. So this is not fitted well. You have people also changing minds, so they start like as crossing as they would cross, and then they change minds, they go to the machine. So this is unlikely, because essentially this breaks like one of the topic model. You have people who are arriving here, and typically normally directly through the type. In this case, you don't know why. They go here, and then they go this way. So this is also not really, this was not one of the topic captures by the model. And here you have one example that maybe there's a video corresponding to that. Yeah, so you have a person coming, and obviously there's some issue. I don't know what's happened. It was, although it's only 7, you know, 8 in the evening, but still. And so, at some point, what is captured is not so much of the necessarily the person falling and so on, but when people arrive, they also make some kinds of more spurious kinds of random motions, which is difficult by the model. We can do event counting, so essentially how it works. if we assume that motifs correspond to event, we can look at when they occur, and by thresholding this, we can decide that when the probability of the for the given topic of the starting time is high enough, that this event occurs, right? And we can count the occurrences to see what is captured. So to illustrate, I mean, this is an example where we have two motifs. So there are more, but let's say we have a motif that corresponds to this and this. And you can see that in general, whenever there is a car arriving here and going in this direction, or a car arriving from this direction, you would have a kind of a red arrow when cars arrives here. So here there is blue, so probably there should be a car arriving, and red, there should be a car arriving here and moving in this direction, except, yeah, this is an example. But here, for instance, this one, is captured. So, and then, so here, okay, this is one of the examples actually where you see you saw two cars and there was no red. And one of the motifs is actually capturing sequences of cars. So actually, it's interpreted by something different. But in general, these methods tend to, as compared to just applying PLSA with longer motifs, as we were showing, here we get like still nice elements, right? I mean, the blue ones, you see there's a car coming here, there should be probably one, but it's going to be slow. That's why the starting time is not as peaky as other ones, right? I mean, because you see it spread like this. So obviously, if you can ground how many cars are coming, and then you can count whether you're able to recognize all the events and compared to other methods that are of things. So here it's a audio data. So essentially, this is a collaboration with EPFL. They install like some microphone arrays on the side of the roads, and when vehicles move, it's the time of flight of the audio to the two microphones is different, and you can measure the when you receive the information between these two instances. Right? This is the time difference of arrival, and essentially, we just applied our technique where we said, okay, the words are a quantization of this time of difference of arrival. And essentially here, you say, well, it's quite easy, but still, whenever you have cars coming, you see that they leave a trace because they go from, let's say, positive time of arrival to negative. So this is right, I mean, the moving. And so, of course, the difficult part is, like in these situations, when cars are crossing each other, then obviously the algorithm for inferring this information, signal processing, has quite some difficulty to do that. So it can be quite noisy, can be more or less active, depending on the speed, can be quite different as well. But then we apply, we automatically get these terms of motting. So this is not with PLSM because, and here this is corresponding to your question. So here we see that we got four motifs when the cars are arriving from far, when more or less it's crossing here, and the same when it's coming from the right and it's crossing. And here we see the topic that currently tries to model different things, but it does not account for lots of observations because this result is based on irrational processes. And then you can do the same. You can count how many cars. And actually, for instance, the people who are collaborating this at design, you know, like some kind of dedicated filter for by modeling, you know, if there's the speed and so on, what should be this pattern and so on. And actually, just learning things from the data, we actually perform at least as good or better in some cases. Extension. So maybe because now still it's a bit late. I discussed about that parameter setting. It's how to define the number of topics. In practice, depending on the cameras you are using, there might be more or less activities or not, right? So you like to define the topics automatically. And also, one aspect I didn't put here is that what about the duration? So right now, we fixed, like we say, we want 30 seconds duration maximum, right? Can we automatically find the duration of activities? So we propose different things, some related or directly processes. So maybe I have 5 minutes. Or yeah, okay. So okay, directly processes, it goes beyond topic models. If you are doing Gaussian mixture models, you can apply this. Essentially, assume that you have a set of data points, which are the words in our documents, but it could be 2D points in a 2D plane or in a 3D plane in a Euclidean space, right? And what Dirichlet processes are doing is to define prior distributions over density distribution. And essentially, there's construction algorithms to get samples of these distributions over distribution. And the construction algorithms allows you to define infinite mixtures of models. Could be infinite mixtures of Gaussians. This is what I had described previously. So it's in the compact form, it's represented like this. This is the Dirichlet process way of representing things. There are two parameters. One is a base distribution, let's say, from which you extract your topics. And here, this is a concentration parameters, which will have an influence on how many topics you are likely to have in your data. So as I said, you can generate samples from this, gives you like an infinite mixtures. So G here, the sample is just an infinite mixture. So here you have two elements here. So you have actually, in the space of distribution, this is, let's say, a kind of mass direct function, which is indexed by your mixture. So if it's a Gaussian mixture model, this is something that represents one of the Gaussian, right? And here you have the weights, right? And here, if I would be finite, that you would say this is a multinomial, right? But here, because it can be infinite, this is actually generated by a process called GEM, according to the people who propose that, and which corresponds to stick breaking process or Chinese restaurant process. Maybe you have heard about it. So here I'm just describing the ways. Since you start, it's you have one probability one, so you draw a beta from a beta k for the k components from a beta distribution, and this gives you in the pi k, this gives you this, and then you remove this part of your stick. And you draw again something, but here you are going to make the product of this variable with only what's remaining. So essentially, the pi k that you are generating from the new element is for the same value is going to be lower because you are going to multiply the parameters by tau lower, right? And this is tick because this corresponds to moving Zach. And there's another interpretation which is based on Chinese restaurant process, but yeah. And then essentially, given that this is a mixture distribution, here it's that if you want to generate your data, you just say, okay, randomly generate a sample from this infinite mixture. So here where theta corresponds to any of the mixtures, so I sample any of the mixture according to pi k. And then given this mixture, if it's a Gaussian, I sample an element from a Gaussian. If it's a multinomial over topics, I generate a word, right? So that's why it can apply to different things. And here you see this corresponds more like to the expanded forms where we actually see, oh, we have here our set of topics which can be infinite, which are all generated from this distribution. And here we have our topic proportions which potentially can be infinite, right? And from which we can sample the index, the mixture index corresponding to each words. And okay, I already spoke about that. So in our case, what we did is that we have a temporal document. We have a set of motifs, right? And essentially, what we do is associate motifs with starting times, right? Which are called occurrences, right? So here it's an occurrence of this motif at this time instance. And there are two ways where we try to have a variable number of elements. So it's in the motifs. We may not want to select the number of motifs. And when we use the Dirichlet processes, this set of occurrence, when it makes its pass, we want as well to potentially have an infinite number of occurrences to generate our document. So here we end up like with two Dirichlet processes, one which is independent of the documents to generate the motifs, and one which is per document to generate the occurrences. Okay. Last one is, so far, this is the model. We have our motifs. We have the start times. Probabilities or no model about how motifs should occur over time, right? There is no, in the inference, we have not introduced any elements regarding that. So what we proposed in our case is to actually introduce some elements that potentially could help us discover cycles, rules, or dependencies between the events. And I'm not going to show the graphical model, but here this is a basic analysis. So here this is our observation. This is the inference of these motifs, right? Each square is any of these. So what we have introduced is, like I was mentioning, a global state for each time step, right? And this global state is going to tell us which event is likely at a given time instance. And here, we are not going to only assume that which are the likely elements at a given traffic cycle, at given there is some activities that are going on, if you have another cycle elements, there's some things that can appear. So this is the first way of generating, which is maybe the more classical ones I spoke about, like in the prior literature. So here we have introduced as well something a bit different, which are called like local rules. So an event can be explained by your previous event with some lag information, right? These events occur, and after 3 or 4 seconds, this event might be occurring or not, right? So, and essentially, we are going to try to explain each occurrence of these elements either by it's coming from a global state or it comes from a local state. So it explains a previous one. And to decide which one, we have to introduce a binary variable, which is select what is the best explanation, let's say, for this occurrence. So what we learn is global behaviors and local rules learned jointly. So let's look at just 2 illustration cases, and these are the 2 last slides. So if we look at this video, this is from Queen Mary, so people are driving left. So that's why the cars are going this way, cars are going this way, and there are many 4 cycles. And here you have the 4 global states. So if I'm in the dark blue, these are the type of activities. Cars are going this way and this way jointly. After the blue, I have the yellow states, which is, okay, for sometimes, these cars which are stopping high are allowed to move to the right. And these are the probable activities under the yellow state. The light blue is, okay, cars moving this way. And after the light blue, you have cars moving the other way. And then we are back to the dark blue, which means this again, right? And sometimes there are some strange things happening. So after the dark red, you have like some blue, but unlike the other cases where the blue lasts for some time, quickly you have a bit of yellow and so on. And essentially, this is like due to the presence of a fire engine, you know, coming into the traffic and breaking the cycle and so on. And this, for instance, the type of things that could help to decide some anomaly. Then if we look at, so here this is mainly, there's a regime, so this is more like global states which explain what's going on in this case. In the case of the far-field data, there is no notion of cycles, right? The cars are arriving randomly, and so the notion of global states, there's nothing really to explain there. But here, if we look at the local topics, so we only have like, we have only 1 state which can explain what are the likely events, what are the events that are likely to occur independently. They have no other cause. So here's your rows explain when you have events like this, what are their causes? The binary selection variable. Is it due, were they generated by the global states or by a previous, triggered by your previous events? And if you look at the red rows, essentially here, you see that it was captured that essentially cars arriving here or from the left, right, dominantly. These ones are generated by the global state. They cannot be explained by any previous events. Versus if you look, we would look into the details of the blue ones. See here, I'm just taking 1 example. Whenever we have this activity, it is often followed by this activity or this activity, right? And here we see that this activity is starting closer to the corner, and this one is starting later. And actually, this is captured because here, we say that this activity occurs after 3 seconds after the start of this one, so after this event, so the car is there. After 3 seconds, the car is often here, or the cars might be here, right? Because again, of course, there's some randomness about here when it ends and so on. But so essentially, we were able to actually interpret that some local rules. Okay, so maybe, yeah, so some conclusion about the model. It's like different types of data, it's general. There's a time-aware dimensionality reduction. It can handle mixture of phenomena. So we start with something where everything kind of synchronization, nothing else. It's based on assumption here that the observations are somehow additives. These are words, right? So this is a constraint. With 2 of my students, Chagan, who is now at, and Rémi Monet, who is now assistant professor in Saint-Etienne. So. Sorry, I used quite of your time, so I hope you liked it. And if you have questions, don't hesitate to ask me now or later. I don't know. Yeah.